this sacred room of peace and comfort to remember and to celebrate the life of Doris and Casey. Casey, to most of us. It is fitting that this service is here at Celebration because Casey has been a member of this church, a faithful member, for 23 years. And the church is just 28 years old. Through the years, she has mentored younger women in the church. She's really been a model for all of us in how to live life with laughter and joy. And today, dear Casey has received God's final and perfect healing. These words could have been written about Casey. If laughter is good for the heart, when you die, Casey, they'll have to wait a while to bury you because your heart will still be beating 3 days after you're gone. Casey did love to laugh, and she loved to get other people to laugh as well. You can already see that today is to be a celebration of Casey's good life. We come together saying thank you, thank you, thank you to God for Casey's long and happy life. For 91 years, Casey has filled every space she inhabited. And today, we celebrate her feisty, determined, and bold presence in all of our lives. Our lives have been made better because Casey has shared this journey with us. In the Broadway musical Wicked is a song for good, and it goes like this. So much of me is made of what I learned from you. You'll be with me like a handprint on my heart. And now, whatever ways our stories end, I know you have rewritten mine by being my friend. Like a ship blown from its mooring by a wind off the sea, like a seed dropped by a skybird in a distant wood, I do believe that I have been changed for the better. Because I knew you, I have been changed for good. We have all been changed for good by Casey's presence in our lives. Today we grieve, but we do not grieve as those without hope.
Keep those steps.
Please pray with me. God of life and love, we give you thanks for your abiding presence. In the midst of our sadness, we feel your comfort and love. We know that you have been with Casey all of her days, and we know that she believed your promise to be with her in this life and the life to come. We know, oh God, that in the end, we just run out of time. Time to make one more new friend. Time for one more sunset on the lake. And time for one more opportunity to worship in celebration. Help us, oh God, to remember that even in our sadness, there will be joy. And when it seems as if the darkness is surrounding us, there will be light. The light of your love and grace. For it is in the name of Jesus, the risen Christ, we pray. Amen.
Good afternoon, everybody. I was asked to prepare a few a few lessons I've learned from Casey. This is volume one. Celebration of her life. I'm glad to hear you guys can have a chuckle. Casey was full of life and full of laughter. And I don't know if y'all noticed, but in that picture where she was with the goats, she was feeding them beer. I first met Casey during a golf tournament, of course, and we immediately hit it off and became fast friends. Well, Deborah Sue here is my spouse. And my life partner, Doris Ann, became my golf partner. We loved playing golf together whenever we could, and dearly loved this church's golf tournament in particular. This year would have been our 21st, I think. We always had her putt first so she could show us the way, and Gail and others, I have no idea how we're going to putt this next Saturday. We also discovered that Casey and Nancy and I love to travel. So when Nancy and Casey and I first took a big trip together, it was to Australia and New Zealand in the year 2000. I'll bet you all don't know, but Casey climbed to the top of the Sydney Harbour Bridge 20 years ago. She was 71, a very young 71. We had fantastic trips to Europe and Alaska, and a very special one to Canada in 2009. We had a double wedding ceremony in the Okanagan Valley in those British Columbian Rockies. It was just beautiful up there. Deborah and I felt honored to witness their vows to each other. But besides golf and travel, I learned even more from Casey, hence the books. I learned how to talk Texan from her. Sometimes I couldn't always understand what words she was saying, as her drawl could tire out a word and make me just ponder what she just said. I learned her Texas version of an often used four-letter word in golf that I thought was only one syllable. I heard Casey use it several times, and I correctly came to know that it was really four syllables. Kawaiapa. And it wasn't just me who sometimes struggled to understand Casey's accent. She loved to tell a story of a Norwegian hotel manager that she needed help from from hers and, for hers and Nancy's evening cocktail. Nancy would get the scotch ready. Casey went on her errand. She went down to the front desk and asked the lady at the desk, "Mass, mass." And the lady got all flustered, and Casey remembered a good friend had told her how to properly ask for that. And the lady went out back, brought her husband back out and said, "May I help you, ma'am?" And Casey goes, "May I have some ass cubes?" Well, we couldn't remember another specific request that she made of Siri. We do know that Siri responded and said, "I'm sorry, I cannot do that." You all likely know about Casey's eyesight worsening over these last several years, and during the early months of COVID, she told a story of picking produce at the grocery store. So she was well protected. She put on a face shield as the mask had been fogging. She was struggling to get that plastic bag open to put your produce in, and she just needed some oysters, so she went. She loved telling stories on herself, and she loved a good joke and a big, deep laugh. She just brought such joy of living with her everywhere. She was a national treasure. We loved our friendship with her deeply, and will cherish her memory living on through our continuing friendship with Nancy. When we all shed tears for Casey, know that it is because she loved us all, and we are blessed to have known Casey.
From the moment I met Nancy and Casey, I knew they were the kind of couple Paula and I would aspire to become. Patient, loving, kind, and generous, not only to one another, but also to others. Nancy, can't see you, but we hope you take comfort in knowing there is no human being on this planet who has received more loving care than you gave to Casey. We love you, and we admire you, and we will miss Casey.
I'm closing with a reading of the 23rd Psalm, a special version of it. I carried this in my golf bag for a number of years, and I read it to Casey, and she just simply loved it. So it goes like this. The pro is my shepherd, I shall not slice. He maketh me drive straight down green fairways. He leadeth me safely across still water hazards. He restoreth my approach shots. He leadeth me in the paths of accuracy for my game's sake. Yea, though I clip through the roughs in the shadows of sand traps, I fear no bogeys. For his advice is with me. His putter and irons, they comfort me. He prepareth a strategy for me in the presence of mine opponents. He anointeth my head with confidence. The cup will not runneth over. Surely birdies and eagles shall follow me all the rounds of my life, and I will abide in the low 90s forever.
My name is Kathy Whitworth, and that was great to call you. You told some great stories about Casey, and my stories are just three, actually. And as you know, Casey loved to play golf. Since I am a golfer, that's where I come in. And we had some great times playing with Casey and Nancy through the years. And there was two instances that I, you'll notice she has a driver, a pitching wedge, and a ball she's gonna take with her. And the driver was, has a story about, we were down in the World Golf Hall of Fame in St. Augustine. She wanted to play golf, and she didn't bring her clubs. We were down there on a special occasion for something. And so she decided to, we were gonna just rent us that far. And so we did, and they were pink clubs, and she played really well, and she just loved to strike. So when we got in, we asked him if we could buy this driver. And they said no. And I thought, oh, well, anyway, she just, I thought she was probably gonna go down there and steal it. And if she had figured out a way, she probably would have. As it turned out, we got back home and Gail Wilson found it for her on eBay. So that's her driver. But it's just like the one she loved. And the other one is the pitching wedge, which is mine, and now hers. But we were playing in Pebble Beach. And I'm sure if you haven't been there, you've seen pictures of it. It's just a gorgeous golf course and one of my favorites. And so we were having a great time. It was a beautiful day. Weather was great and not too many bad things going on until, and then we got to the 11th hole. One of the harder holes on the golf course, as it is, but she hit two good drives. And for some reason, she she was just about 30 or 40 yards short of the green. And I thought, she said, well, what do I hit? I said, well, hit a pitching wedge. And she said, well, I don't have one. I said, okay, well, have, use mine. So she basically, and I was thinking of a nice, kind of a soft shot. Well, she didn't have very far to go, of course. It took a while, big swing at this thing. And I mean, it didn't get off the ground. It was about a quail high, just straight at the pin. But fortunately, and it was just going lickety split. And, but it hit the pin, and it went in home. So later on, I gave her the pitching wedge. But you know, she has a golf ball, so she's gonna have something to play with when she gets up there. And I'm sure God will probably want to borrow that driver, but only if he promises to give it back. But anyway, Casey's been the greatest Paula, and they've said they're. She's been a great friend to all of us, and especially myself and Betty, but it's been great fun. She's put us in contact with all of y'all, and I've been blessed with a lot of great stories in my own life, and it was always great fun to be with Casey, and she tried her best on that golf course, but she enjoyed it. It was fun to be with her, and of course with Nancy as well. But, anyway, she's going to have a great time up there now. So I'll just give it over to Betty now, I think.
Hello, everybody. Well, I know for a fact and thankful that everybody here has tons of Casey stories and memories. It goes without saying. Kathy and I both honored Nancy to say a few words and share a few of them. Nancy and I were trying to remember the other day. I think I met Nancy and Casey, and I think we decided in 1976. So from then till now, there are many, many, many stories. It was very hard for me to pick. But I thought very appropriate to share one of Casey's gotcha stories. We all traveled. We traveled all over the world. We've done so many things, many, many golf related. And we've been in New Mexico. Kathy's from New Mexico. We've been in many times. On one of those trips, we decided to make a little jaunt to down to Madrid, not far out of Santa Fe, an old mining town and artist colony, if you will, now. So we did that one day, and Kathy and I have a favorite gallery. There's an artist-owned gallery, so we went in there first. And I decided, I'm going to show them. So I pointed out one of my favorite paintings in that gallery. Immediately, Casey said, "That's the ugliest bleep thing I ever seen." Casey, but as I did, I glanced up, and about as far from me as the flowers by the organ stood the artist. An owner of the gallery. And I tried not to react, but anyway, we didn't stay long. In there, we decided to. I said, "We'll go to the next door gallery." So we did that. Anyway, months later. In fact, all I remember is that it was celebrate golf tournament. The tournament was coming up. We were at a committee meeting at Tarrant County Junior College with Joy. And Kathy and I were the last ones to get to the meeting. And when we did, Casey presented me with that painting. Oh, yeah, shock probably doesn't cover it. My mind was it was reeling because I was like, the one thing I knew for sure, there would be no way on God's earth that Casey would have parted with that much money. But here it is. So I couldn't come up with another plausible explanation. And I was just taken back. And I love it. Well, came to find out that Casey solicited the help of our own and very talented Bonnie Watkins to replicate that. And Bonnie, wherever you are, I know you're here. She did. And she nailed it. And it hangs in our house today, and I love it dearly. Casey, you got me. Big time. I mean, totally got me. So I thought, well, one more story, and I'm going to switch gears. This story is one of my favorites. It's a couple of things. It's a little insight into Casey's nature. And all about her endless love for Nancy. She called me one day, said, "Betty, do you have time to talk?" And I said, "Yes." She said, "Well, for a while?" I said, "Sure." And she said, "Well, I know you know." And if she said that one time during this phone call, she said at least 10 times. She said, "I know you know that Nancy's getting ready to retire." I said, "Yes, I do." And she said, "And I'm happy about it." And I said, "I know, I do. And I know Nancy's happy about it. I have no idea where she's going with this." So she said, "Well, yes. Okay. Well, I also know that you know that I get my daily chores done every day. In the house, in the yard, shopping, cooking, you know, all my stuff. And Betty, you also know that I don't start that until I've read the four-star telegram about 3 hours. I do know that. And she said, but I get them done, right? I said, yes. And she said, I'm really worried. I mean, her tone just changed. She said, I'm really worried. I said, about what? And she said, well, first of all, I'm afraid my life is really going to change, and I'm not sure exactly how, but I know it is. I said, yeah. And she said, but most of all, and she said, no, wait. I also know that you know that I love Nancy more than life itself. I said, I do. And she said, I'm afraid it's going to pull us apart. I'm afraid it's going to affect our relationship. I thought, boy, baby, what are you going to say? I thought, well, truth is always good. I said, well, Casey, I have to agree with her. I think you're right about one thing. Your life is going to change. And she said, well, yes, and I mean that in a good way, but you know how Nancy is. This is an organized person. She knows what she wants, and she wants everything done, and she's going to want this done this right now, and this right, I can just see her doing this. And I said, yes, I do. And I said, that's why I'm saying what I'm saying. Yes, that's it. Your routine is going to change. No doubt about it. But I guarantee you one thing, it will never affect your relationship. It will never. There is nothing on God's earth, Casey, that can come between you two. And I said, I also know that after a period of time, you're going to be able to get back to your regular. And you and Nancy will be just fine. And all will be. We'll have this conversation again, Casey. And so in closing, I hope our friend Jorge is here today. I was trying to think in all my thoughts about Nancy and Casey. Jorge is a dear friend of many people in here, and I think Jorge says it best. Anytime Jorge refers to Nancy and Casey, and he's probably unaware, but how it comes out is Nancy Casey. It's all one. It's all together. It's all one. Nancy, we love Casey. We love you. I can't see you, but we love you. Hey.
Thank you. Shadows of this life at dawn, I'll fly away. you from Proverbs. A cheerful heart is good medicine, but a downcast spirit dries up the bones. From Psalms. And then our mouth was filled with laughter, and our tongue was shouting joy. And then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we rejoice. And from John 10, I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. Jesus said, I am resurrection and I am life, and those that believe in me will never die. I am Alpha and I am Omega. I am the beginning and the end and the first and the last. And because I live, you shall live forever. Doris Ann Casey was born May 4, 1930 in Fort Worth, Texas, to Thelma Lillian Smith and her husband, Robert Randolph Casey. She died on May 27, a few weeks after her 91st birthday. She survived by her spouse of 49 years, Nancy Crosskill, her nephew, Bill Casey, and his wife, Ginger, from Albuquerque. First cousins, Jack Jones, Joel Fowler, Catherine O'Connor, and Sandra Kay Posey. She was preceded in death by her parents, by her brother, Billy Bob, and a sister, Marcy. She's also survived by numerous cousins, and a host of friends. The name Casey is mononymous. I had to look that word up. If a name is mononymous, it means that a person goes by one name. Their life is so big and they are so known, they can go by one name, like Cher. Who happens to be older than Casey, but Adele for Socrates, and Doris Ann became Casey. Casey graduated from Northside High School, and at the age of 17, went to work for First National Bank. The tender age of 17, and she stayed there for 35 years. She retired at the tender age of 52. Casey loved to say that she had been retired longer than she worked. Everybody has Casey's story. I was very fortunate not only to be to be a friend. I think of Casey, I think of laughter and joy in her big life, and how she loved golf and people and garage sales and wearing this stupid mask that was just horrific that she and Ted Sammons would wear and scare the liver out of people. She loved fishing. She loved chili. She loved hot water cornbread. She loved hot peppers. The hotter the better. When she traveled to Europe, I heard that Casey Tunchet took a bunch of little bitty plastic bags, and each one had enough jalapeno peppers to get her through that day in Europe. Casey was competitive. Very Casey played wheel. I'd show her a picture of a fish I caught, she'd say, it's plastic, isn't it? this one so close to the hall, you should say, you kicked it, didn't you? One of my favorite Casey stories is when she was a mere child. There was a family get together, and all of the cousins were there. She and her cousin, Jack Jones, wanted to go play. Casey's mama said, you can go play, but you can't leave the little cousin. You've got to quit running from them. You've got to take care of them and take Joel and Carolyn with you. And they didn't take Jack and Carolyn with you, and they didn't want to take Jack and Carolyn. They were young. They were kids. So they passed by this cemetery, and Casey knew this cemetery backwards and forwards. And she happened to know of this mausoleum that had a chain on the door that looked like it was locked, but there was no padlock on it. So she and Joel said, Jack, Carolyn, look inside, step over here, look in here, we're going to go in here. And here came Jack and Carolyn. And Jack tells of how Joel and Casey just pushed them in and closed the door and chained them. And left them there. Then went off to play, and I'd say, Jack, how long were you there? And he said, about an eternity. And eventually later, Jack said, we cried, and we were scared. We cried. Later, somebody came, brought him out. And Casey would tell that story when she'd tell it. God bless her, tears would stream down her face. Not tears of sadness, but tears of laughter. And she'd say, that dadgum Jack Jones, anytime something doesn't go right in his life or he can't do something, he'll say, it's because Casey threw him in the mausoleum. Casey had shared with Ted Salmon that IRS time, the new IRS time was coming. She said, you know, I've done my taxes. I don't know what's going on. I've got this rental property. I'm not quite sure that I did it, but I'm hoping to get money back, and I hope I did. So Ted and Casey were always playing jokes on one another, and Ted had a good friend called Casey at work. And this person said, hello, I'm Mrs. Wilkinson. I'm with the IRS. And we are very concerned about your taxes that you have sent in. It doesn't look right. It doesn't look good the last number of years. We want you to bring all your paperwork. We're going to meet with you tomorrow and bring your checkbook. This looks good. Casey was scared. It made her sick in her stomach. And she went home sick. And Ted let her sweat until late at night when he told her it was a joke. Weeks later, Casey got her hands on this rattlesnake skin. It was about 6 feet long. You could still see where the little rattles were at the end of the snake. And once when she was over at Ted and Jack's, unbeknownst to anyone, she put that snake skin under the bed. And in a couple of days, Ted Salmons was calling Casey, oh, I found a 6-foot snake skin under my bed. And Casey got, oh, that sounds bad. If I were you, I'd look at my bed before I got in, and I'd be afraid to put my feet on the floor. I'd look at my shoes. Years later, we found out it was Casey. We had the opportunity to fish many times. Casey and Casey were fishing buddies on many occasions, fishing in church tournaments. We spent a week at Bull Shoals fishing camp. If you had never seen Doris Casey and Ev Mulder clean fish. It was an art form. It wasn't pretty, it'd make a grown man weep, but they could clean fish like you would. I remember a particular fishing trip at Cedar Creek Lake. We were on our boat, it was early morning, it was one of those mornings that was cold and foggy, but it was gonna burn off and get warm. Casey was at the front of the boat, we were gonna catch crappie. And Casey was standing there holding her little plastic bottle of green Lipton iced tea. She offered it to me and said, "You want to hit?" And I said, "No, I've got my diet coat, Casey, I don't like it." She said, "Would you hold it for me a minute?" I said, "Sure." Then she pulls this Morton salt shaker out of her pocket and she shakes it and takes a drink of the tea. And I realized that's not green tea. It was then that I realized that Casey and Jose Cuervo had a long and abiding relationship. On Casey's last minutes here on earth, Doreen and I were on one side of the bed, Nancy, family, friends were on the other. And Doreen was saying this beautiful prayer holding Casey's hand. And I remember thinking, how can I not have Casey in my life? And then I realized, because of who she was, she'll always be in my life, in my heart. I will always remember her steadfastness in the church, her love of laughter, her love of people, her teaching me that even though you couldn't get a hole in one, you could still have fun at all. She taught me the importance of try. Keep going, keep moving. So you're 91, sign up for the golf trip. Play. She taught me to enjoy the Midway, State Fair. She taught me about love and laughter. Casey will always be with me. A number of years ago, about 20, I was invited on Easter Sunday. We had not a whole lot of members here then. RV group was at its open lake, and it was Easter Sunday, and they said, "Come on out and do a sunrise service." A great group of people. And I went out there and I took one of these with me. It looks like a dried up piece of evergreen. It's called a resurrection plant. Some people call it a star to home. And no one has reminded me of this or marveled on it or was more enthralled than Casey. Because it's like resurrection. It's a dried up shell. And here's one I put in a bowl of water when I got here. You stick it in water and know it's been wadded up and dry for years, it's turned to green. It lives again. And that, beloved, And that's how it is for Casey. We'll see her again. I know that she's in heaven. Friend, family. Jesus said, I'm the resurrection and I'm life. And those who believe in me will never die. God bless Doris.
Thank you.
In Romans 8, we read, who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Birth and death are transformative moments in our lives, and they are bookends to smaller transformations. We die from one thing to be born to another. Rule Howe, theologian and educator, went to a city where he once served as a pastor, and he learned that Charlie, one of his closest friends in the church, was in the final stages of cancer. So he went to the hospital to visit him. Charlie was very lucid up to the very end, and he was willing to talk about it. And Charlie said, Rule, I always wondered what it would be like to die. And now that I'm up close to it, lo and behold, it's an old friend in new garb. Rule said, well, say more about that, Charlie. And so Charlie went on, well, several times in my life, I've had the experience of letting go to a little world so I might gain access to a much larger world. I remember one morning when I was 6 years old, my mother came into my room and said, today, don't put on your play clothes and go outside. Put on your good clothes. You're going to school. Charlie said, I had no idea what school was. I had never known anything but the sand pile and the swings. And I remember looking out the window as I was putting on my clothes with a great deal of apprehension. Sadness. And I ventured out to this thing called school, but lo and behold, it was a place where I became things I could have never become if I'd stayed at home in the backyard. There were books, there was science, math, new friends. My whole world expanded as I left the one to enter the other. 6 years later, I had to let go of that school and go to a thing they called junior high school. And 3 years later, I let go of that and went to high school. And then I let go of that and went to college. Charlie went on, he said, in all of these experiences of letting go of the little that I might have access to more, I have learned something, an abiding pattern. Every exit is also an entrance. You never walk out of something without walking into something else. I am confident that what I'm about to experience, Charlie said, is of that same order. As I relinquish this physical body, I don't look for this to be the end of everything. It's another experience of letting go of the little, so I might have access to more. Now, Rule Howe thought this was a magnificent statement of Christian hope. And 2 days later, Charlie did in fact die, and Rule was still in the city, so Charlie's wife asked Rule if he would help with the service. He did. They had the liturgy, and when they came to the end, the ministers walked out in front of the casket. Rule said he was trudging up the aisle in front of Charlie's casket, and he had this terrible sense of heaviness and ending. But just about that time, he looked over the back door. The back door of the sanctuary was a sign. It was illuminated, and it said, exit. He remembered what Charlie had said. Every exit is also an entrance. We want so much to cling to the safety of our present location. We know this place. We know how to act here. We know the people. And God says, let go. I'm with you. My boy Jesus is here too. You're not alone. We will walk with you and show you the way. And Jesus says, I'm going to prepare a place for you. I'll be there, and you'll be there with me. The joy, laughter, and love that Casey enjoyed in this life is nothing compared to what is to come. And you know, Casey never did want to miss part. And there will be joy, laughter, and delight. C.S. Lewis wrote that heaven is where God leads the revelry in an eternal dance that makes heaven drowsy with harmony. We're all invited to that party. Now, Casey was so ill with COVID in January, I think that's right, and we wondered if she would survive it. But survive it, she did. We watched as with grit and grace, she began the difficult work of recovery. Physical therapy, learning to walk again. What a gift it was to us to have her for these last few months. She lived her life to the fullest until the moment last Thursday when she couldn't. When the doctor told Nancy that Casey wasn't going to be able to come back this time, we stood around her bed, as Carol described, as she gradually crossed from this life to the next. And there were tears of sadness. But it didn't take long for us to realize through our tears that our hearts were filled with gratitude for Casey's long life. God entrusted her with gifts of faithful love, kindness, love of animals and children, integrity, and Casey used them for all of her 91 years, sharing them with friends and strangers alike. You know, there's some people that die and leave us with a silence that is deafening. Haruki Murakami writes, I said nothing for a time. I just ran my fingertips along the edge of the human-shaped silence that had been left with me. And that's what's happened to us with Casey's death. There is a human-shaped silence that has been left with us. But I'm convinced that if we wait a while, the sound will return every time we see someone. Teaching a child to fish. We hear someone laugh as they enjoy watching children swim in the lake. For then we'll think of Casey, and we will offer to God a thank you. Thank you for her good and faithful life. We can just imagine that last Thursday when Casey moved to the next life, that Jesus was there. Welcome home, Casey. How are the new eyes? Some of your friends and family are already here and they're preparing a welcome party for you. Why don't you just sit down here by the water for a little bit, fish a little? There's a pole for you and a bucket for your fish. Welcome home, dear Casey. Welcome home. Amen.
Amen.
Amazing God, we came here today to witness our faith, to grieve,
We thank you so much that indeed the eggs. We thank you for being with us in this time of hurt and pain. We thank you also for such a big life and a life so well lived. We thank you for the joy and the wonder and the peace. Casey, we pray especially for Nancy and your presence with her dreams. We thank you indeed for drawing us closer to one another and closer to you. It is in your name we pray. Amen.
I promised Nancy that this service would just be an hour, but with somebody that had such a big life, it's hard to get it all in 1 hour. And now as you go, may God grant deep peace of the running wave to you, deep peace of the flowing air to you, deep peace of the quiet earth to you, deep peace of the gentle night to you. Moon and stars pour their healing light to you. Deep peace of Christ, the light of the world to you. Deep peace of Christ to you. Amen.